everyone, and welcome back to another episode of the Knife Nuts Podcast. And we are joined by the Advanced Knife Bro.
Hello.
Yay!
It's about time. I have to say, this is an episode I've been looking forward to.
Yeah, since the Eye of Sekhmet episode of Dude, Advanced Knife Bro.
The Eye of Sekhmet changed my fucking life.
Do you have one of those?
No, I just love the video.
You just keep watching your video.
I certainly do not buy that flashlight, but...
It's not cheap. No. It's cool, but it's not cheap. I have one.
It's like, so just to put that out there, it's a wooden box with a large lens in it and a light.
Half copper and half like finished wood. So it's like, and on the inside there's like heat sinks and stuff. I've actually taken it apart once because my switch started sticking. So I sent it back to them and they fixed it for me. But I looked at the inside of it, and the inside of it's like, it's pretty complicated versus a regular flashlight. So there's stuff going on in there.
Which is why it looks more like a bookend than a flashlight.
It looks more like a bookend. It does. Sitting on my bookshelf.
What the fuck is this thing?
It's the Eye of Sekhmet. Let me just say it the way he says it. Eye of Sekhmet.
Eye of Sekhmet.
I had to Google it because I completely thought we were talking about something else. This is wild.
Yes. It's like a handmade thing, you know? It's like... It's a custom knife of flashlight.
This looks like a relic that like Brendan Fraser is going to go looking for.
So what's funny about that? I love how we got into some crazy information within the first 20 seconds of the podcast. That's a first. Two, your concept of custom flashlight actually makes more sense than everyone else who listens to this show's idea of what a custom flashlight is. They're usually thinking of like a $800 to $1,000, titanium barrel flashlight company or something like that. Whereas the custom flashlights you're talking about actually produce a lot of light.
They do produce a lot of light. And like the main difference is like, you know, I know about those titanium things. And a lot of times those are just like machined, like out of metal. And they're just like, they use generic drivers and they put stuff in there like that. And so you're basically like paying for like a machine shop and not like a completely new engineered product. And like the Eye of Sekhmet's more like a totally different type of light, you know?
It's artisanal, would you say?
It's an artisanal light.
It's the fine cheese of
it's small batch, handcrafted.
Yeah, I mean, but some people don't like it, some people like it, but you know, whatever.
That's enough about the mutant flashlight. Mm-hmm. We're just happy to have you on the show. I wish you could tell us a little bit about yourself and why we have you on this show.
I don't know why you have me on the show, but I can tell you about myself.
Yes, do that.
You don't want to like start with my early childhood. You like, how did I get into videos type thing?
This is a very long podcast.
Go for it.
I listened to one four days ago. I listened to your last episode.
I'm sorry.
I don't know if that was a good one or not.
I don't know. It was. I don't listen to a lot of podcasts. Like that's just, I listen to music on my commute.
Me too.
Yours is the only podcast I've listened to out of podcasts, unless my wife listens to them. So there you go.
All right.
You're going to be really pleased when you start listening to other podcasts.
And yes.
you set the bar really low for yourself.
Yeah, you're very naive about how bad this is.
You guys, no, I learn stuff because like I don't follow I follow products, but I'm not completely immersed because there's a lot of different things that I'm interested in. So it's like not just one thing. And you know, the knife world's a pretty big world.
Mm. Which is the first time anyone has ever said that ever.
Yeah.
Yes. It's like a big, there's a lot of stuff going on.
You're 100% right. And you know what? I think that's what we find so fascinating about your knives is because it's such an untainted view on that type of product. So tell us a little about your channel and what you do.
And your childhood.
And what makes it... And your childhood, sure.
My childhood. I grew up in Missouri. No. So my channel, I started it a few... I'm doing lots of likes and ums here, so...
We'll edit them all out in post.
We'll edit some
when
of
I
them
record,
out.
When I record my videos, it's a nightmare to try to edit my voiceovers. Mm-hmm. They take forever. So my videos, few years ago, like I think I started my channel in 2012 and I didn't really put much on it, and I was hanging out on flashlight forums because I was looking for a camp light and I saw they were giving free lights away to people who would review them, so that's kind of how I got started. It was kind of a impulse thing. And I got into knives because flashlights kind of got boring. And, you know, I like pocket knives. I like Leathermans. I like multi-tools because I use them for work. And my videos are kind of inspired by, I went to film school. And
it shows.
That makes sense now.
and I didn't really use it. Like, my industry that I work in is not really, it's like tangentially related, but I kind of draw on like my inspiration that I got from movies and techniques from film school and just a variety of technical knowledge. I'm kind of a camera person and a lens person too, you know, other mm-hmm. than knife and flashlights. So my videos are...
You're like a Renaissance man. Look at him.
I can
studies,
do a few things.
He studies the arts.
I study the arts.
And the blade. Yeah.
So yeah, my videos are just a culmination of my film school and then like personal things that I'm interested in, you know? I have collections of things and knives and lights are one of them. Another one is video games. I don't really kind of get into that, but yeah,
we play video games.
Yeah, I have a lot of old video games. I have two or three full shelves over there of like
classic video games.
Yeah,
like,
just from Xbox One all the way down to the Intellivision.
Okay, so Vectrex. I have a Vectrex. Did you say?
Yeah.
Oh, the Vectrex is a very special system.
It is.
We'll have to have that conversation another time.
Yes.
But I do have one video game question. This basically how I judge every person I meet: Sega Genesis or Super Nintendo.
I grew up Super Nintendo.
Mm.
I have a Sega Genesis CD32X over
okay,
there.
Okay. Well, that sort of alleviates all worries. As long as you have that.
Yeah, I have like 40 games for it, I think, or more, maybe.
I don't think they made any more.
Was the Sega Genesis the right answer to that question? Because I'm going to go ahead.
Sega was the right answer. I can tell by the way he asked.
Super Nintendo exactly. was the right answer.
That's false.
No, Super Nintendo was a far superior system.
I didn't have money for both when I was a child.
If you're a baby.
I mean, I was a baby when Super Nintendo came out, but I still had it. Yeah. I'm rocking with Super Nintendo. Super Mario Bros. All-Stars is incredible.
That's for children. Yep. Child's game.
That's a child's game? How about Family Altered Feud Beast. From 1991? That was great. Oh, that's one of my favorite Super Nintendo games, man.
You know the year Family Feud was made for Super Nintendo?
I wanted to say, I played a lot of it. And it's also, you have to, like, when you're doing a trivia game that is 30 years old, you have to try and mm-hmm. get into that mind frame and think of what the answers would be. From 1991.
It probably says 1991 on the title screen too, right?
Yes, that's also true. Yeah. This isn't that expensive.
I think we should add some bonus footage of us playing Family Feud together.
It's a great game, and I believe it is up to two players.
So Brian, what would you choose? A Sega Genesis or a ColecoVision?
ColecoVision.
I know. I could tell by his age.
Brian would be playing.
I got a ColecoVision.
I do too.
No, Intellivision, sorry. I have ColecoVision games.
ColecoVision, I feel like, is superior to Intellivision. In many
I think
ways.
Graphically, yes, you're correct.
Yeah.
There were games that were actually sandbagged for other systems to make them look better on the ColecoVision. So, like, there were games that came out, like Donkey Kong. Donkey uh-huh. Kong came out on the ColecoVision, and they also ported it to, like, the Intellivision and... tons of different stuff, right?
Yeah, it sucks on Atari 2600.
It sucks on every, even though it was, even though they say that those systems were graphically capable of doing it. It's very strange. Marketing.
Anyway,
how did you get into knives?
You know, I've carried Leathermans and stuff since my film school days, and that was my multi-tool because I needed something that did more than one thing, you know? So
Hence the multi.
I had screwdrivers, so I carried one of those, and I don't know, a few years back, I just kind of got in. I was looking at, like, buying the right knife, and I bought a Spyderco, and then I bought a few choppers to go camping with, and it kind of just ballooned from there over a few years. And
Do you think that the equivalent knife question would be Benchmade or Spyderco?
Yeah, because those are probably the two most popular. Like, out of all of my videos, like, I do kind of oddball things. Those are the ones that get the most views, so I kind of like, somebody says, hey, I have a Benchmade, I can loan it to you, or I'll say yes because it gives me clicks.
Content.
It gives me content and it gives me clicks.
Yeah, it gives us content when we shit on Benchmade too.
Oh my god!
Everybody shits on Benchmade. It's fine. It's okay. You know,
unless it's a 940.
Unless it's a 940, that's like the right. one.
Yes.
I like Benchmade. I have a lot of Benchmades and I've spent a lot of money on them, and I don't.
It's okay to be wrong, Mark.
It's
you're justifying your purchases.
I don't know. I don't justify any of my purchases like that. I just, they just work, you know, they work as knives. They work.
They do.
They
work. I do. They do. And we've talked about this before. Like my gateway knife was a mini Griptilian.
Mm-hmm. Same here.
Is there and I don't even like that Benchmade. I mean, I don't hate it. It's just not my style knife, you know?
No, mine was partially serrated and coated.
I mean, at least I can say that mine was a mini Doug Ritter grip, so not quite as
somebody just sent me a Schrade partially serrated to review.
Nice.
They said they were sending me an out the front, and it's not an out the front. And it's partially serrated, so I got a review on that.
How did they get that part
very,
wrong?
Very funny. Because this is the cat. He has filthy casuals that watch his channel. Mm. It's out the front. It comes out the side, but it's an out the front.
Yeah. So I don't know how my angle on that. I mean, it's like a decent made knife. There's nothing wrong with it. It's just that.
Does it look like another knife heavily? Because that's Schrade's MO.
Yeah.
Yeah. They got the angles on the side. It's just I don't even remember which one it is. It's at work. I left it at work all weekend. And
what sort of situation are you in where you can just leave your knife at work?
Me? Oh, I work in a shop and I bring my stuff to work. Hopefully nobody's listening to this. And I work on my videos at work sometimes, like in the mornings when no one else.
We'll edit that
the weekends,
part
I'll record voiceovers there.
Nice.
I don't have a quiet house very often. So like my voiceover times are like, I have to, sometimes they're 5:30 in the morning. Sometimes they're on the weekends at work, you know, whenever I can get them in.
I mean, my favorite voiceover thing is, I can't remember what video it was, but your daughter started making noise in the background and then you made the same noise as her and just continued like nothing happened.
Yeah. I
need more of that.
She does. Sometimes she's off camera. Sometimes I don't put her in my knife videos very often because I don't
want the bad publicity.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I don't put her, like, she would show up in my light videos because, you know, there's nothing wrong with that.
When she's old enough, you have to teach her how to baton stuff.
I will. She has plenty of knives to choose from for me. I have a lot of them now.
Nice.
For those who don't know, Mark, aka the Advanced Knife.
Don't put his government out there.
I'm putting his first name. Is that all right?
Well, now
yeah, it's fine.
Okay.
We can beep it out or put baby
sounds. I'm collaborating with Cedric and Ada, and he says my name in his intro to my video, so it's going to be out there
all
soon.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, the Advanced Knife Bro here. You know, what was I going to say? I forgot my whole point.
For those that don't know,
his real last name is Knife Bro.
He's well known for his Knife Bro. He's very well known for his batoning. He batons everything.
I was going to say he batons everything.
It was a joke, and then people, when I don't do it, they say, "Hey, why didn't you baton that wallet? Why didn't you baton that whatever?"
baton
everything, and I just do it because sometimes I don't know what to put in the videos, and if I put that, it's like a favorite. People just like, "Oh yeah, okay, good."
It's like coming home like to a warm fire or something.
Exactly, and they're like, "Okay, now I know where I'm at."
a warm house fire.
It's a warm house fire. That's what batoning is. Yeah. I don't do that in real life. There's no, I'm never like.
No. There's not the situation where you're in where batoning something is important.
No, it's never been important. I just do it because it's irritating and it makes people mad and then other people laugh at it.
I got something to tell you. I don't think anyone thought that you ever needed to baton anything.
You don't. And I say that in one of my videos and people still will comment, "I don't know why you're batoning that knife." And I'm like, I don't know.
Controversy likes.
Yeah,
and views.
I find this very surprising. I thought you were pathologically obsessed with batoning.
No, I don't do it. I only do it on the camera.
We're seeing how the sausage is made.
Yes. I wouldn't say I'm good. I just do it. It's not hard to do. It's like drinking a glass of water.
I've seen people fuck that up too. So.
I've never cut myself drinking a glass of water.
No, I've never cut myself batoning.
Yeah.
It's safer because the blade is literally lodged in a piece
lodged
of wood.
In some wood.
Like, it's not going anywhere. It's like people are like, "I don't know how you haven't cut yourself." I'm like, unless the blade breaks in half and shatters into a million pieces.
I do like
happen,
when
I guess
when the lock fails and you just keep batoning anyway.
I like that. Yeah, so I sent the link to Kershaw.
Kershaw. I call it Kershaw now.
I don't know which side you emphasize.
I think it's stressed, unstressed.
I brought that up in a video. I don't know. I don't pay attention to that.
Benchmade.
bench made.
Yeah, in English it usually goes stressed, unstressed, but I'm willing to reverse it. I like Kershaw better.
Yes. Kershaw. So the Shaw?
Spider-Cop. We're starting it now. It's going to happen.
So they're like, you're not supposed to baton with that. And I said, sorry.
No way.
People like it. Yeah, they said that.
Kershaw was pissed?
They weren't pissed. She just said, hey.
Who did you get in touch with? Because their social media manager was flaming people out here on Instagram. Oh my God.
He was burning it down.
No,
man.
This is a lady. Dude. I've dealt with Isadora for years, and she seems to be nice.
Oh, okay.
Isadora?
Yeah.
Shout out.
I don't know if it has anything to do with I never contacted them through Instagram.
Oh, their Instagram social media manager was on a war path. He's at like the people's necks.
He's like the Wendy's of the knife community.
It was the exact opposite of what a PR person should be doing.
Yeah, what did they do?
It was amazing.
Someone said that one knife looked like another knife, and went nuts.
People get sued for that.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm not going to mention any names here, but I've spent plenty of time on Blade forums reading the drama.
Okay.
And so, you know.
If you ever want to hear more about it, you should listen to the Knife Nuts podcast.
I don't know who listens to these. Like, I'm trying not to like make anybody mad.
Just under 20,000 people.
Just under 20,000 people?
Yes.
20,000 devices. How many of those are people and how many are robots listening to the podcast? I couldn't tell you.
Well, I got my channel's got like 25,000 viewers, and
yeah.
I think my biggest video in a while has been my Leatherman Wave video. And that was like, that's like almost a 10,000. Like my viewer, I haven't had large videos since I stopped doing flashlights and they started doing the purge a few years ago, you know? So
it's only because we have purple knives, dude.
Purple knives.
Yes.
Got it. Well, yeah, that's 20,000 devices is a lot of devices. Kudos.
Hey, I mean, you have more subscribers than us, so give us your tips.
It's YouTube subscribers, though.
So my beer video that I did like 2 days ago is currently sitting at 700 and something views, which is my worst video. And I thought my last beer video was the worst one. Actually, this one is. And I spent a lot more time in it.
I love that you soldier through these and just continue to comment on how bad they're doing.
Yeah, they're terrible. Time.
They're so good though.
You know what? I will say, like some of them, like the one that before this that sucked that people didn't watch. You know what? That one wasn't that good. This one that I put a lot of time into, and I put some real good jokes in there. I'm like, but this is the one that I want people to watch.
It's never the way it is.
One gets the impression that you are very close to giving up every single video.
I'm glad that comes through because I feel that way. Sometimes I'm like, I don't know why I'm doing this. What am I doing? What is this thing that I'm doing?
Let me tell you,
I know that feeling.
Something, buddy. If you quit, we will collectively quit. Because there will be nothing for us to idolize.
Do we just sign a suicide pact?
Aspire to.
What about all the, there's a lot of knife channels out there. There's a lot of them. There's some good ones.
Yeah, but your approach is different.
Go ahead, name your favorites.
Cedric and Aid is like probably my favorite. I don't watch a lot of YouTube. I'm pretty sure that comes across in my videos.
Just like you don't listen to a lot of podcasts.
I don't listen. I just don't. Like I spend so much time working on the videos and like doing stuff. It's like I got to take a step back and commenting. I don't know if you noticed that, but I'm like a serial commenter on my. Like, I respond to, like, nearly everybody.
I only get... whenever I comment on your videos, I only get a Advanced Knife Bro loved your comment.
It's because your comments aren't good enough.
I guess not.
Because if your comment isn't controversial or really threatening to him, then you're not going to get the kind of response you want, Levon.
I guess I'm going to have to publicly shame him somehow.
Yeah. I did get into arguments on my beer video about pores for... I spent 30, 45 minutes responding to people about my poor. I don't know why I did that. That was like the Mac, the hard drive argument I had on my Patreon going live Instagram post like a few weeks ago.
A hard drive argument?
I got into a hard drive argument.
Yeah, you
got
to tell me about this hard drive argument.
It just was, I was like, I spent $800 on hard drives and the guy was like, you got ripped off. I'm like, well, like, 12 terabyte external hard drives or not.
Are they solid state?
No, it's not even solid state. Like, you can't get a bare.
You got ripped off, dude.
You can't get a 12 terabyte hard drive, even an internal one, for under like $400.
Oh, is this a single drive that was 12 terabytes?
It was a single drive.
Oh, I thought you were doing like a NAS setup or something.
No, I can't afford a NAS setup that gives me the space I want. Like,
what
that was
2004.
And plus network attached servers, I'd have to run like cabling in my house, and I live in a rental, and I just prefer to have a hard drive under my computer that runs Thunderbolts faster than NAS anyway.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Whoop, whoop. Shut up.
So when I move an 8 gigabyte video off my main hard drive.
Do you record in 4K and then downsample it to 1080p, or do you record
no,
in 1080p?
No, I have an old computer, so I do everything in 1080p. 4K is a bunch of bullshit, and when people point 4K cameras at their tabletops and they go, look, it's 4K, it's like, nobody has 4K TVs
or monitors. Yeah.
Or monitors. Like it's like an expensive super steel, you know. People who buy expensive super steels rarely use them to their full potential. Yeah, you know what I'm saying. otherwise there wouldn't be lots of A-minuses on Knife Swap.
Ooh.
Wow.
Yeah, like you go to Knife Swap, it's like A-, B, C has been sharpened once.
That hurts.
That's true.
That hurts me right in the feels right now.
What's really funny is that when you amount a certain amount of knives, it really doesn't matter what steel is made of.
It doesn't, because you don't sharpen them, that you spread it across all the cutting edges.
Yeah, I want someone to like send me a knife and I have no idea what the steel is and see if I can tell anything, because I call bullshit on 99% of people being able to tell anything about steels.
Yeah, you read those comments, they're like, well, my experience has been, I've read many of them. And Cedric and Ada, like, he does a steel test. He's like, this is how many cuts this gets in. This is how many cuts this gets in. If somebody wants to pay, you know, $300 more for 100, 200 more cuts, go for it.
I feel like there are so many variables in those tests, it's not even funny.
There are. And my easiest to sharpen knives have always been my super steels anyway, because they match the angle grind of my Spyderco. Mm-hmm. And like, it takes me 2 minutes to touch up my Benchmade 941.
You use a sharp maker, don't you?
Yeah, so I use it. It takes me like 5 or 10 minutes to touch it up, and that's all it is. I'll spend like 45 minutes on some HCR shit that has a, you know, a uneven edge grind, and don't even get it sharp. Yeah, it's true, man. My most expensive knives are usually the easiest to sharpen.
Yeah, I mean, consistent bevels are the most important thing for sharpening. Yeah.
And it's not necessarily, you know, a lot of other things.
This is why I hesitate to recommend the sharp maker to like people that are just getting into knives, because guaranteed no cheap knives have consistent 15 or 20 degree angles.
They don't. The easiest ones to sharpen for me were always the Gonzo knives I did. I don't know why, they were like all the other ones, like the San Remus and the Endlands.
Because they're made of pudding.
They're made of pudding. But it just, you know, it's I don't necessarily have conventional views in the knife world. I like a lot of knives.
I think you have very factual views, or at least experiential views. Is that a word?
Yeah, that's a word.
I mean, realistic. Like, I don't.
Yes. There's very little bullshit.
I don't. Yeah, you know, and people can spend money on whatever they want. I don't. That's, you know, I'm not going to judge them, because I have expensive things too. I spent $1,000 on a camera lens, you know.
You got to have good glass.
Well, it also is a fast lens. There's actually.
All right. Okay. Wait. Canon or Nikon?
Neither. They're too expensive.
That's a good
Micro Four Thirds. I shoot all my shit on Micro Four Thirds.
You're a strange bird. You know that.
1080p. I've shot on Canons when I used to shoot wedding videos. They would Canon Mark 5D Mark IIIs.
Hmm. That's a great camera.
Yeah, it's a great camera. It's just, you know, it's a $2,500 camera, and when you're shooting 1080p stuff, like, you know, I know other channels that use expensive cameras that you wouldn't even be able to tell.
No.
You can't tell, as long as you shoot it, you know. And I'm not even my cameras, people can shoot better than I can on mine, and it's all about lighting and color correction and stuff, not necessarily how much you spend on your camera body.
Absolutely.
Sorry, I just went off. Sorry, no. I've been talking.
Dude,
what else?
You know, it's such a nice change of pace to have a guest that likes to talk, because
It's not pulling teeth.
Usually we're basically
why thank you.
Trying to Shang Tsung the soul out of some people.
Okay, somebody else talk about something. Somebody else.
You're the guest, man.
Oh,
this is a very advanced night. This is a very special episode.
I don't have anything important to say.
Well, let's talk about your knife collection, because that's something that we talk about often amongst ourselves.
I don't actually ever show that, or because I don't really keep track of it very well, but yeah.
Neither do I.
Ask away.
So I know there's a couple highlights in your collection, but why don't you go and name your like top five ones that you carry? Because I know there's got to be at least five.
Yeah, my top five. I carry my Leatherman Wave. I know that's not technically a knife, but
we'll count it.
I've been carrying my Spyderco carabine a lot. I love it.
That's a strange one.
It's a huge blade in a nice, comfortable handle. That's it.
It looks like a Striper album cover.
Yeah, well, it looks weird, but it's a functional piece of equipment.
Now, let me ask you this. Did you actually buy that one?
Yes. Most of my knives, I will say in my videos when I don't buy them. I'm also, anybody ever wants to ask me, hey, who bought that or who paid for that or whatever? Like, I usually make that, try to bring it up in the video or whatever. But yeah, I paid for that one myself.
Well, the only reason I say that is because, like, I looked at the price of it because it's not a cheap knife.
It's not. It's $160. Spyderco gave me clicks. That's why I pay for those too.
I gotcha. And I guess that was a good one to do because you don't see much on it. But it's a compression lock folder, right?
Yeah, I love compression locks. They seem to treat me well.
And it's like anyone who's going to go buy that's going to just go, I can go buy another Paramilitary 2 or
a
PM3.
The Paramilitary 2 has a smaller blade, like, and it's like not really much lighter.
Yeah, I've been carrying the Spyderco Shaman, which is a larger knife with the compression lock.
It's got a shorter blade than the.
Probably does.
Yeah,
it does. It has a smaller cutting edge and it's heavier.
Also, LC200N is getting pretty popular. People are
Lots of good things are being said about it. I've noticed.
Is that the salt knife blade steel?
No, that.
Yeah, that's the one that can't rust.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, H1 was what they used in the old one. Yeah.
Yeah.
H1, right?
Yeah, it's the super steel of the new. Rust-free shit.
The only thing I noticed about LC200N is it gets like a weird film on it. I don't know how to describe it, but I've seen this and I have a Spyderco Spidey Chef and it just always looks dirty, the blade. I have no idea what it's from. It's weird.
Mine looks okay. I have it here in my hand.
It also
right
scratches
now.
Super easily, even though it's not soft. Like it holds an edge right, well, but it scratches so easily.
I have a few big scratches on it on the side.
Oh, it's
not,
super
not gouges.
Yeah, it's super easy to scratch LC200N for some reason.
Okay, so you have the Leatherman, Caribbean.
Spyderco. I carry my Paramilitary 2. Okay. I carry my Benchmade. I like my Benchmade Fact. That's an unusual one.
Oh, yeah.
One.
That's the long one with the aluminum handle.
It seems kind of useless.
No, it's fine. The pointy tip, like, you can't find a pointier tip. Like,
true.
It's like, I can remove tags from clothing with it, whereas I can't with other things. It's like a... like a little mini dagger.
It seems such overkill to remove. Have you ever tried just pulling the fucking tag off?
Yeah, but like you rip it.
Have you tried batoning the tag off?
Yeah. Oh, good idea. That my Benchmade Fact, that my Paramilitary 2, and I've been trying to carry my Chris Reeve occasionally, but it just sits around.
The Chris Reeve people. They listen to this. So what's your message to them?
Hey,
I never carry your knife.
I spent $1,000 on a camera lens that can do things that other camera lenses can't do. But if somebody wants to spend $500 on a pocket knife that does things that other pocket knives do just as well, go for it.
Wow.
I resent that.
Shining review. Yes, that's true. Dave has an unhealthy obsession with the Reeve knives.
Yeah.
Well, Reeve is priced. The knife thing is kind of like that. People like, do people like price bicycles or like other tools or other machines, like simple machines? Knives are like kind of a weird anomaly.
I equate it to cars often because
cars. There you go, cars. You can buy a $20,000 car that can get you to point A or B. Or my car is a Honda CRV, and I paid like $4,000 for it.
Ultimate practical.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I mean,
practical knife.
It just sounds to me like you haven't let the light of Lord Revis Christ into your life. So,
I've held. Somebody wants to send me the 21 to review, and I'll review that.
I thought you already had one of those.
I just,
Isn't that what you
no, have? No, 25. He's going to send me the 25. All I have right, a 25.
There you go.
There we go.
Sorry. I take that back. Yeah. He's sending me the 25, and I got to get back to him.
Let his love into your life, my child.
Yeah. I don't know if these views, like, these are okay to express. Like, people may stop watching the channel, or people may just, I may get a lot of hate.
You can say whatever you want.
We generally say whatever we want, so.
I have a lot of knives. I'm with people on knives. I have thousands of dollars worth of them.
That's good.
So, yeah.
So we on our show, we have an interesting perspective because one of our hosts is an established knife maker.
I was listening to that. The guy who does the typhoons.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. That's Brian. He's just over there to the left.
Oh, is he here?
In internet space. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. So that's, so if you had one thing that you don't probably interact with too many knife makers in your daily.
Right? Zombie Tools sent me their free one, and I like that one. That was worth the $280. I would have spent $280 on that.
Oh yeah, that wasn't. It was a bigger fixed blade, wasn't it?
Yeah, it's a Kukri.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I actually enjoyed that review. That knife seemed good.
It is. It's great. It's like that's worth $280. It is.
How about intricately made folders made in a garage in New Jersey?
I've actually had a few knives that I want. Like I've seen the Hawk knives, the one, the automatic that's going to come out soon, the revision 4 or 5.
Mud?
I had the prototype of that knife.
Oh. Yeah, that thing right there. Like I know how much that those cost. To me, that seems like it's worth it because like a lot of time looks like it's put into it, but if it's going to be made on a factory floor, like, you know, with, you know, hundreds of employees, and they're going to start charge like $400 or $500 for it, then to me, it's like, I don't see the
value starts to crumble. The idea, the artisanal aspect.
And
eye of Sekhmet, let's bring it back around.
And he's like the you know, because I was reading the article, they were talking about the screws, like the screws are meant to be not stripped out. Like, I would love to pay $200 for a knife that doesn't have shitty screws.
Yeah.
That's a common complaint in the higher end.
Why are you charging $200 for a knife that has soft screws? I mean, I could go to Lowe's and buy cheap soft screws for
Brian. What are your thoughts on that?
I mean, I agree. If you're spending that kind of money, it should be pretty decent. That's part of why I don't use titanium screws, though, is I'm not very fond of them. I don't like, no matter what you do to put them in, you bitch them all up, taking them out if you don't snap them.
Mm-hmm. Brian, have you ever watched any of the advanced knife? Oh yeah, you did, didn't you? You watched some of his videos.
Just the one.
Just
wait, guess which one it was.
The Magic Eraser.
Fair enough. We do great research before our guests come on.
Yep.
That was such a pleasant surprise.
Advanced too?
Magic Eraser.
I don't even know most of the people in my industry.
So I was thinking, Brian, and now that I have Brian and the Advanced Knife Bro in the same place. I was thinking of sending him one of my older field grade Typhoons to beat up. What do you think, Brian?
You can throw it in a lake for all I care.
That's what I thought you'd say.
Classic soundbite.
Sure. Have you ever had a custom folder on your show?
No, I've tried contacting a few custom knife makers before, and they don't like, you know. You know what? Medford returned an email. I actually got an email from him. He said, scared. Hey, I don't give out any knives, but I watched your video and awesome. I'd love to see it. So like that, like actually meant a lot to me versus like nobody ever returning my email. So,
hey, that's great, but I'm not going to give you one. Like you,
I don't, I said reduce, like free, like, hey, loaner. Like I don't, it's like, I just kind of put it out
there. I imagine nobody wants to give you their knives only because like they know they'll get batoned and then like,
I have $500 flashlights that people would throw at me.
Oh,
knife world's different than
Well, because people don't want. I would imagine manufacturers don't want videos of their locks failing on their knives because, you know, most people will realize that you're not supposed to baton with it, but there'll still be like a contingent of people who will be like, this is a shitty knife because it lock failed when it got batoned. So
yeah, there's very little things that can go wrong with the flashlight. My battery is at 20%.
This is the struggle of having a show that blurs the line between technical and comedy.
Mm. Yes.
So the point is that I'm going to send you a Typhoon to baton with.
Well, I actually don't. There are things that I haven't batoned with where somebody sends them to me and I say, hey, they say, hey, just don't baton with it. I'm like, okay.
No, you can baton with it. Because if it gets really messed up, I'll have Brian refinish it.
Yeah, good luck. Those are long gone.
There is actually
yeah,
one.
Yeah, that's true. There's definitely no way I can get that replaced. That's great.
High stakes.
Still gonna do it though. Still gonna do it.
There was one knife that I didn't baton with that I realized many months or years after that I did the review that the lock was kind of shitty, but it. I mean, I don't really use it that much, but it has a. Like you guys were talking about the zero tolerances the other day.
Oh yes.
Yeah. I mean, because I was listening to what Brian was saying. He's like, well, why are you using a knife like that? And I agree with him. Like, but I also have done what you've done, and I press on the back of them sometimes just to make sure that lock's just locked.
Right.
And I can see how that would happen.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, if you're theoretically using a knife in a quote-unquote tactical situation, right?
Yeah.
I mean, this...
Have you read the... I think it was the Blade Forums thread a few years, like, I don't know, it's a few years old. It's like, how many people have used their knife in an actual self-defense situation?
I'll take it a step further. Let's see. I would like to see if we could go an entire week with only using our knives in reverse grip.
That would be, that's a great challenge. The reverse grip only challenge.
Yes.
I have a coworker that says he's scared off people with his knife before. He hasn't used it, but.
What is it?
It was a karambit. It was a cheap karambit of some sort.
Yeah, the person was...
He's like, I flashed it, and some guy was walking toward me, then he turned around and walked away. So, I mean, there you go. Like, that's the one story I've heard.
Maybe he walked away from him because, like, this guy's a fucking weirdo.
This guy just whipped out a karambit. I'm going to go the other direction.
He forgot he left his iron.
He can't hurt anyone with that.
Maybe he went to, like, go get the nearest emergency services for when the blade folds and, like, cuts his hand on that karambit.
Mm-hmm.
Did I just hear a turd hit some water?
What'd no, sorry, it was my beer. It was my beer. It sounded like a turd. It was beer going back.
No, out. it was this podcast hitting the water.
Yes, that's right. It was. We could actually hear our listeners just stopping.
Yeah, I mean, I can see a body of water from my window right now. I'm about to throw my computer out right into the lake.
Just wing it right out of the window.
It's where this podcast belongs.
So in other news, we started a Patreon. I know you did the same thing, Mark.
Yeah, it, you know, it's, I think like $80 a month. What are you guys getting?
Slightly more than that, but not much.
It's all bullshit because it's just friends.
And it's, it's all just people who've been listening to the podcast for a long time. Mm-hmm. But this is our plug for our Patreon right now. I've officially made this the plug. So with the Patreon, we have a lot of people doing, you know, $5 a month. That gets them a really cool Knife Nut sticker. At $10 a month, you get our fancy PVC patch. Yes, very, very cool patch. At the $25 level, you get entered to win a monthly knife giveaway. And I don't know what our knife giveaway is right now, but we should think of something.
We need to give something away.
Yes. So on the next episode, we'll probably announce the winner for our first month's Patreon. And then we also have $50. One that so far no one has partaken in.
Oh, what a surprise. But
the $50 tier allows you to get on our show with us for, 15, 20 minutes? I forgot how long you said, but it's something to do. But if you're in a position to, you know, help support, we appreciate it and we'll make it worth your while. You also get access to this show a little early, which is good.
And other bonus content to be determined.
Other bonus content, to be determined. Yeah, we're going to try and make this a regular thing, too. So,
and if 10 people subscribe at the $50 level, we're going to baton with the Hydra.
Yeah, sure. That'll happen.
How much is enough to buy a new one? Because that's what we'll
you can't.
Buy. Yeah, it's a good point.
I'd be fucked. I have irreplaceable knives, Mark. It's not good.
No, I've seen some of them.
Baton with them.
The one that they're referring to was made in Israel.
Mm-hmm.
So it would be a little bit of a hike to get that one refinished, quote unquote. Yeah. So that would be one that I would have nightmares of people batoning with. I don't think I've usually cut something with every knife that I own. I don't think I've ever cut anything with that. That knife just exists as an ornament.
My claim to fame in this little group is somewhere along the lines of about a year ago. The part of your brain that makes you cautious and makes you care if a knife is expensive or rare. That thing just fell right out of me because I'll use any knife. I use every single knife and any knife without any.
Kind of like that time we had Popeye's chicken.
What?
What knife?
It fell right out of us.
Oh, okay, gotcha. It was a poop joke.
It was a everybody. Swing and a miss.
Poop joke.
Yeah, I use all my knives too. That's what they're for.
Yeah.
So, Mar, are you a big outdoorsman? I'm getting that impression because you've been doing so many fixed blade reviews recently.
Since I've had the kid, not as much. But I used to go. I didn't birth it, but my wife did.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah. So, and we got another one on the way too.
Oh,
congratulations!
Yes. Not that I don't really share like my personal life on that thing, but I don't think anybody knew or really cared, but.
Well, you're not showing yet, so.
That's good. I'm not showing, so that's good. Although I cut those angles out, the unflattering ones of the videos.
Interesting.
Where I am. I like camping. I grew up in Arkansas, and you know, I grew up in a house where, you know, we had the centerpiece of the house was a gun cabinet, and we had, you know, we shot, we hunted, we fished, and I kind of grew up with that. And since I've had to live around major cities, and I've that's like kind of been disconnected with me a little bit because if you live in cities, you don't live around water and the outdoors. But my wife works in the outdoors. She works at like national parks and
stuff. That's cool.
She doesn't currently work at a national park, but she has in the past. And so we would go backpacking and camping and hiking, and you know,
that's what I do.
So.
That would make sense out of the 940 review, where hiking with a child on your back. I found that hilarious.
Yes, she was sleeping. That was her first hike, and So I don't claim to be the like a super outdoorsman, but I do like camping. You know, when we travel, we don't stay in hotels. We take our tent and we camp in a tent. So that's
So do you know the company Survive Knives?
No, I don't.
Oh, okay, interesting. I thought that might have been on your radar.
So here's a piece of news for you.
Yeah, this is so Survive Knives was this company. They started, I don't know, 2013-ish. They were on Blade Forums. Anyway, they make these like, I think Pete from Central Canada has tested them, some of their fixed blades, and they made these really high quality fixed blades, and they were crazy in demand. I mean, they were selling out in like seconds, and they were selling for $200, $300. And now they just got kicked off of Blade Forums because they're basically just scamming people now. They still have undelivered. They admitted that they have 20% of their orders from 2015 are still undelivered. And wow. Yeah. I wasn't sure if you ever had the opportunity to check out one of their knives.
I have not. I generally, if it's a when I do reviews, I do actually research. I make jokes that I don't. So I generally follow some of the drama on the major knife manufacturers. But I actually hadn't heard of them because I don't know if my sense of humor is good for, you know, blade forums. Like I'm there, but I'm not there.
No, that's fair.
They don't really get sarcasm there. Yeah. So.
They don't, and I see it's just like audio video forums and stuff that I actually know more about, and those things are the same way. It becomes a contest, and I, you know, I'm just a guy that really doesn't like to argue.
But
so
I would say get your hands on one, because apparently for all intents and purposes they're actually really great outdoors knives, but the problem is you can't get them.
And there are people just waiting that have already paid.
Yeah, the best part is they said that part of the problem is that their manufacturer had a fail rate of 30%. So we're throwing out 2/3 of the knives, or 1/3 of the knives that were made, and could only sell 2/3 of them, which is...
So it was probably millet.
I'm just kidding.
Whoa.
I'm totally kidding.
I don't
totally
get that kidding. Joke.
Totally kidding.
Millet knives is a OEM. That
and they make good.
Yeah, I see. I actually follow them on Instagram.
Yeah,
yeah, they make. You will get that joke if you stay down the G&G Hawk path, because they have used them before.
Mm-hmm.
Yikes!
So Hawk makes prototypes and they send them to small manufacturers to make. Is that the idea?
Well, actually,
okay. Go ahead, Levon.
Well, if you want to, go ahead, Jake. If you can.
No, it was very
aggressive.
For all the Hawk knives that you've bought. Go ahead. Talk about
it was the plumbing in your house that he made fun of. So That's you can feel that.
This is so passive aggressive. I can't take this. You're like a married couple.
Oh yes. In case you didn't know, Jake and I we're very familiar. We're basically married.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So most of the stuff that Grant and Gavin Hawk make are custom, but they're moving into a meaning that they're made in house by them using their machines that they've made. All sorts of crazy stuff, including the Deadlock, which is the one I think you were.
Yeah, the Deadlock. Sorry, it just was escaping my mind. I don't have mine.
Right. Those have never been produced by anyone but them.
They look amazing. They look like they're worth every penny.
They're incredible. They really are amazing.
I just want to get that out there that I can't appreciate expensive knives, but like it has to be a good knife.
Oh, first and foremost, and has to be a good knife. There are tons, and that's basically what our podcast exists for, because there's tons of expensive knives that are trash.
Yeah, I haven't ventured out into that territory as much because like I have a very limited channel budget, and most of my time is spent creating videos and not talking to people, you know. And so I don't get.
Well, you seem very personable.
No, I am, but I don't reach like I don't cold call people.
No, I understand.
Yeah, you don't have an in-house schmoozer like we do.
Yeah.
I don't have any connections in the knife world. I just kind of do this in my yard, you know.
Yeah.
It's kind of refreshing.
But that's why we love you.
Yeah.
But the point is that they do make production knives through that American manufacturer Millet.
Okay, so Millet makes their production.
It's an American manufacturer, yes.
I like the mud. The mud looks good. I just didn't have like $450.
The mud is a Millet-produced knife.
Got it.
It used to be a custom.
Yeah, I signed up for their alerts whenever they sent them because like that's actually a custom knife maker that I, you know, like they make good stuff, you know, it seems.
Yes, very much so. And I remember that the one that everyone seems to gravitate towards, like, Brian and I were at a get-together last week, and everybody pulls out incredibly expensive knives. There's some crazy stuff there. But everybody gravitates towards my Serge Panchenko and Gavin Hawk Orbit because of the crazy action that it has. I think you saw that one, Mark.
I have. I've seen the Orbits. I follow Serge on Instagram, too, and I browse his website occasionally. He makes interesting stuff.
I'll have to send that to you to check out. That's not what I want you to baton with, but
I can treat people's knives like well.
I think you'll enjoy that. I'll send that over to you.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's how that works.
Mark, I have a question for you.
Yes.
So everybody else basically at this point, since Andrew Jean, the Edge Observer, are you familiar with him? His videos? He took them all down, so it's kind of hard. If you just got into YouTube, then it's going to be difficult.
I think I'm familiar with the name, and there may have been a chance I've seen him.
Yeah, so he was, for people who don't know, and I guess people might not know at this point, because he took all the stuff down, he was another person who was a videographer who put an insane amount of effort into his videos, doing all sorts of crazy things to make videos about knives. And at this point, I think you're like the only person I can think of that really actually has any kind of production values. So like, what motivates you to do that when desktop sort of zero production value reviews where people just do it in one take and just sort of go with whatever they get, kind of what is it because you love, I mean, you have film school experience, you like, is it because you like that, is that what motivates you to do it? Or
I like making things like videos that amuse people, and that's what motivates me to do it. And I have to like come up with new things because there, you know, there's a lot of tabletop reviewers out there, and there's a lot of people that don't get views, and you know, that sucks because there's really popular ones out there that are no better or no worse, you know what I'm saying, as far as that goes. So I feel like I have to kind of go above and beyond, and I need to have like gimmicks, and I need to do things. So it's like, that's why I spend a lot of time writing, a lot of time editing, a lot of time thinking about, you know, the stuff that goes into them, because I make the videos that I would want to see.
I genuinely don't know how you do it. Like, I mean, the amount of time just thinking about trying to get to it is insane. Because literally, we have no preparation whatsoever.
Yeah, that's the only reason this is manageable.
So my video creation process is like, because I record my voiceover at one time, I video stuff it like another time, I edit it another time. So it's like they're piecemealed over the course of like a week. And when people loan me things or people send me things free or or, you know, I have to send them back. I'm like, hey, it takes 3 to 4 weeks because sometimes like I don't have any ideas in my head and it takes a while for me to come up with a dumb gag or something interesting or new. You know, I try to mix it up, try to surprise people a little bit. And, you know, sometimes I make up things on the spot. Sometimes I have to sit down and think of a skit like that. The last video I did, the Svord one, that took me like 6 hours to write.
Weirdest name for a company ever. Just put
It is.
Svord is just a weird company in general.
Yeah, they make interesting knives. Like that knife is a $200 knife, and it's not a flawless knife, but there's a charm about it, and that's what
you like. Its handmadeness.
Yeah, it's, and you know, again, some people like wouldn't pay $200 for a knife that has those things, but I see why people like it, and I don't see anything wrong with that value if the value is attached to it. You know, if
I'm sure the three of us would have paid $200 for something much worse.
Yeah, and that's the thing is like if I feel like there's love and there's like attention made to a product, like the price can go up exponentially. You know, as far as, but like if somebody's gonna, you know, sell a factory knife and it's just a variation of their formula, you know, it's got to be reasonable.
Also, in our line, like, there's no amount of love or care that can fix horrible pivot tolerances.
Yeah.
You know? So there's that.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. Pivot tolerances. Like that's, if a knife doesn't have, like, you're talking about like
the actual functional stuff that makes it a working knife.
Yeah. If it's not functional, then you shouldn't, like, you guys were talking about the locks, right? You know?
Oh yes. So, correct.
That doesn't really bother me. That, like I said, the knife that I was talking about was, the guy, the country music singer, Zach Brown.
Oh yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, that knife turns out doesn't have a very strong lockup. I like it, but it doesn't have a strong lockup.
Southern grind.
Yeah, I don't know if that means the knife's bad. I don't think so. I think it's a great knife, but I don't use it very often because
I had a bad monkey as well. It was all right, I guess. It was in my older days of collecting.
Yeah, it's too heavy of a knife for me to carry because it's copper.
Oh, the copper ones are ridiculous. I mean,
yeah, I don't.
In retrospect, I also should have felt ridiculous paying $200 for a knife with 14C 28N, but, you know.
Oh, yeah. For
these things happen. Yeah. Someone's got to send you an Emerson. That would be fantastic.
So, you know, there's a guy that buys me knives and just will send them to me. He's like, hey, here you go. He bought me, like, a Benchmade and
wow,
got a Swiss Army knife.
I believe it's called a Sugar
Occasionally
Daddy.
People do that. Like the Svor knife, the guy bought that knife and he sent it to me, you know?
No, that's nice.
Must be nice to have a sugar daddy.
Well, I have a few, but they don't.
Nice.
And that's the thing is they just will send them to me and they don't ask anything for it. They're just like, hey, here you go.
Yeah, that means you're doing something great.
Dance for me, monkey.
I give my knives away. I don't sell them. So, yes. You know, I don't resell my stuff. I give my knives to my brother. I've given Benchmades away to my brothers, my family, and I don't talk about giving things away on a channel because that can't happen because I have, you know, thousands of subscribers, but I do give stuff away and I put stuff on my Instagram. So
yeah.
Oh, yeah. You gave away that Browse recently. I remember.
I paid $150 for that.
I wish someone had stopped you, but it made for a good video.
No, and that's the thing is like, I do pay for stuff that I know that I can get some sort of,
didn't we double down on that giveaway with you? I think we did. I think we gave away.
Yeah, because I know because I was listening to one of your podcasts and you guys were, or was it a podcast or did I see an Instagram post where you guys were ragging on them and I know that people do. So
I know that people do.
I'm not going to make any comments necessarily about them, but I'm aware of what people talk about.
It's very diplomatic.
So yeah. I decided that you would be a good group to link.
I know, and we got a good laugh out of that.
Mm-hmm. So. But I mean, it wasn't a bad knife. I can't handle the handle, you know?
Yeah. Which one was it? It was the one that was
back.
Really awful, right?
Yeah. Razorback.
It's definitely.
Oh my God.
It's his Wote knife, the worst of all time.
That you think that's the worst?
No,
one?
The Tyrant is worse.
The Tyrant. I can't even picture that. You know, my mind must have erased it.
I mean, I even feel bad when the man is posting about his marital issues in his Instagram stories. Like,
oh,
I feel like
man.
We can't even make fun of him anymore.
Yeah, once knife makers start putting up sympathy things,
yikes.
That's when you know it's There's something
legendary one I always reference about a certain knife maker and a divorce, but...
Wait, which one is that?
I think I know who it is. The drunken YouTube video about a divorce that was taken down shortly after, and there's, you know...
Do they make expensive knives, like really expensive knives?
That's a great question. I don't even know what they're going for these days, but he is a custom maker. Yeah. And it was a very embarrassing YouTube video. We'll send it afterwards, but...
Just say who it is and bleep
just
it out.
Just say it and bleep it.
Yeah, you're not the one that has to do the editing, man. You know how long it takes to bleep, out one thing? It's a whole process.
We should start bleeping stuff out with funny sounds.
Ugh, what was this?
Just want to put that out there.
No, we're above that. We're not above much.
We're literally in the cesspool.
We're not above much, but I'm above funny noises as a gag. I'm not putting fart noises in the background. I refuse.
You know, someone emailed us, and well, actually, it was a comment on our actual podcast thing on Apple Podcasts, saying that you sound like the alien from American Dad.
I don't get it, but I trust our viewers or listeners.
Unless that he was talking about me because I'm the posh fat one.
Yeah, there was some good insults in there.
Oh yeah.
Mark, I do enjoy whenever you get insulted, and then read the comments in your videos. What was the one about George Clooney? About looking like George Clooney?
He doesn't even know.
Something about meth.
It was
cousin.
Yeah, it was in the most recent video.
Brother, something like that.
Hey, oh, hi, Mark.
Did we lose Mark?
We lost Mark. We killed him. That's it.
Now's a great time to add.
This is where we put the sponsor thing.
The clip about our sponsor.
Yes. Yeah, well, this is where we'll put the clip.
Oh, I forgot we're doing a clip now.
Yeah, just put the one from last week in there.
Oh, yeah, I'm just going to recycle it.
Because I do want to get one recorded by a sensual woman. This episode of the Knife Nuts podcast is brought to you in part by PVK Vegas. PVK has been selling knives on the internet since 1996. They are the largest microtech dealer in the United States, specialize in automatics and balisongs, and have a strong selection of high-end customs. Visit their showroom on the Las Vegas Strip, a five-minute walk from the USN show. Use coupon code KNIFENUTS for 5% off your order.
All right. Technical difficulties.
What's happening?
Elevator music. Well, guys, and good news, I just been upgraded to VIP status at Brugger's Bagels.
Wow.
Your boy is a legend.
Is that extra lox or extra cream cheese?
Dude, I had to lay off the bagels. I gained like 30 pounds in a 2-year period, I think, attributed to bagels.
And you're still like the smallest human I've ever met in my life.
We just have an abnormally sizable podcast.
That's true.
Mark's actually gone now.
Yeah, I think he probably realized he could probably hear us, but we couldn't hear him, is my guess. So he probably is now doing the little, I'm going to sign out and sign back in sort of situation. So Brian, while we're waiting for him to come back, you sent out the first round of micro typhoons.
You know, apparently I thought it was only 2 boxes. Apparently they sent 3 boxes.
What the fuck?
One of the boxes got held up in customs, and I had to fill out paperwork for Homeland Security bullshit. That one they still have. Hmm. In the meantime, 2 other boxes came. 2 days ago, a box came. I instantly got those wrapped up and sent them out. So I went through them, wrapped them up, put labels on them, and sent them out all the same day. That was about 50 of them. And then today, the 3rd box came, and I just opened that up, and then I had the podcast, so I didn't get to do anything. But I'll get on them tomorrow.
I mean, they look like they came out as good as we assumed they would come out, so...
So far, so good. They all look good. You know, none of them had any glaring issues. You know, I went over them as best as you can before you start sending them out. You know, I mean, you know, I check center, I check detent, I check lockup, I check for blade play, any scratches, any bullshit like that. But and then they go on the container and get shipped out. So
nice. I mean, if there's anybody who you really don't have to worry too much about their manufacturing, it's Riot. So,
yeah, would you say you were like impressed, or you know, was the consistency noteworthy?
They were very consistent. No, they were pretty damn good, man. From one to the other, they all felt pretty decent.
That's really tough to do.
There's a couple here or there that this one felt a little snappier. Maybe had a little more detent. I mean, lock bar pressure or something like that. But for the most part, they all seem pretty good. Now, but I'm already getting the texts or DMs and shit like that.
You got any extras?
What kind of? Oh no, I've been getting them since I stopped taking orders. What am I going to do to them? Am I going to, what's warranted, what's not, blah, 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 all that shit. Am I doing spot treatments? I don't even like doing it on my own knives.
I'm still thinking, well, first off, that's ridiculous too.
Yeah.
I think it's funny that his production knives got held up in customs. Sorry.
I'm surprised you didn't have to pay any tariffs on them.
Yeah, pun master over here. Never ceases.
Attila the Pun. Just call me that from now on.
God. I'll call you no such thing.
And he's giving himself a nickname. Just to round out the cheesy.
Everyone knows you can't give yourself a nickname.
That's fine. By the way, Advanced Knife Bros internet took a shit.
Okay.
He said, give me...
This clone went back together pretty nice. Feels like a million times better.
We're still recording, wow. Jake. You know that.
Yeah.
You gotta keep the clone shit on the DL.
Something more interesting to say? Oh yeah, the clone shit. Yo, speaking of
that, it's a sponsored clone from Elijah, though.
It's a clone of a Browse designed by Isham and basically sponsored by Isham.
Yeah.
Isham.
How come Fuckers. I can't say? So okay, can we let's take
yeah,
a minute.
You Mr. Dom
let's take
Steel.
Shut the fuck up. Let's take a minute and take a poll. It's not Dom of Steel. It's Damn Steel.
It's always been Damn Steel.
But you even said it this time a little bit different than you normally say.
Dom of Steel? I say Dom of Steel. That's what I say.
Yeah.
I always assume it was Damn a Steel. Like dumbass.
Damn a Steel.
not quite like that, but sure.
I heard the distinct sound of hardware hitting the floor.
Yes.
That was just a $50 end mill.
It ate a $50 end mill no more.
Did it take a chip out of your floor?
No. Luckily it landed on the rubber first. So it might have chipped the tool, but it's good,
Brian
enough,
and
for my,
I are
good
both,
enough for my shit.
Brian and I are both fiddling with end mills at the same time. Except his are $50 a piece and mine are like $4.
Typically, I don't use expensive end mills.
No.
This happens.
Dude, you got to use expensive end mills because then you can bitch and moan about every time they break on Instagram.
Tooling costs.
Yeah. Oh, you know what?
That hurt my head.
I've used, especially when it came to the ball mills, I bought like $200 quarter-inch ball mills, and then I bought the $8 cheapie just to see, the difference. The other ones are definitely better. But not enough to make up that kind of difference.
Yeah, this is a classic Will Moon strategy. You post a picture of your broken end mill, and you'd be like, ah, oh, man. Gotta delay the knives. Gotta raise costs. These end mills aren't cheap.
I mean, you guys rip him apart all the time, but I tell you what, when I went and saw him at Blade Show, I really didn't think there was anything wrong with any of the knives that he showed
me. Nah, they're donkey dick, dude. That was a good time to rejoin us, Mark.
Oh, hi, Mark.
Yeah, my internet just like sometimes the router resets.
Yes.
So, I mean, it gave us the opportunity to give the room quote. So
they're donkey dick, bro. they're donkey dick, dude. Well,
the one I had the one we had for a bit, right? Had some issues, Jake. Right?
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't
terrible. Yeah. I mean, it had some. I feel like the lock bar was just the lock bar was just wrong.
Generically, I would say it didn't seem like he had
finished the knife.
Yes,
I mean, like it would maybe cut your thumb eventually on the lock bar if you used it more than twice.
Yeah, the ones I saw at the show seemed to be pretty decent.
Well, he did say that he went back and changed.
Yeah, let's just push all this drama off on Dr. Frunky anyway. He's already got his beef with Will Moon. I don't feel like starting another one.
I saw that the other day.
have you gotten into any beef with anyone via the channel?
No, I don't. I try to be nice to people.
He's like the T-Rex from Toy Story.
Who, Frunky?
No. Mark.
I don't.
Advanced Knife T-Rex.
No.
Yeah, he avoids confrontation.
I don't, and that's the thing is like, I don't.
Advanced knife confrontation.
I don't badmouth like people on my channel because I don't. I want other people to work with me.
Yeah, it's just so much easier to not do it.
What's funny is it hasn't held us back in the least.
I don't know. Mm-hmm.
Well, let me tell you this.
I like to get along with everybody. I'm not one that.
I was afraid enough to say something on here that maybe would get me in trouble.
It's not my nature.
You're not a very combative person, Brian.
No.
Peace, love, and
positivity. And whatever.
Positivity. So let me pose a question to everybody here, and it's nice to have an independent adjudicator, Mark. So I appreciate your take on this.
How so recently have you redacted a threat?
No, that's not what we're talking about. What I would like to talk about is a specific knife maker who has who is very controversial. Very controversial.
Oh, good.
Very controversial. And has nonstop shown interest in coming onto this podcast to air out some laundry. And I've told him that time and time again that I don't think it's a good idea for either of us and to work on his reputation and start building some stuff and get knives into the hands of people. And then we could talk. You know, that was my way of like shoving it off for a little bit. It was funny because at Blade Show, he had told me to. This knife maker that we're talking about is none other than Paolo Balzano. Okay. Mm-hmm. He had asked me when I was at Blade Show to go check out a couple of knives that he had at a table. He said, I just want you to go check them out. And I'm not expecting anything. I just want you to tell me what you think. So he had like four knives there. And I went, you know, I said, what do I have to lose? I'm going to go check them out. Right. And I went and saw them. Lo and behold, the knives are very nice. They're not bad, right? I had some issues with them, and I told him about them and all that kind of thing. And I was like, my thing was that the issue with him was never the quality of the knives. It was the fact that nobody got them. And that's been assured, and there's a lot of crazy stuff going on. But the main thing that I want to ask is, should we have him on the show?
Nope. Not worth
Brian?
It.
Brian?
I think you should. I mean, because you've commented about his stuff enough. You've commented about what he's done. Give him a chance to fucking speak up. It's not like, how is that reflecting on us because we're giving him a chance to...
I mean, I'm not buying any of his knives. I'm putting that out there right now. I'm never going to put money into his knives. But I do think as a, you know, not that we're a legitimate media source, but I think it would be an interesting show. And the reason I'm asking this publicly is because I don't want it to look like it was, you know, this is exactly what's been happening. And I think it would be an interesting thing to have him talk about stuff. And if it gets too crazy, we could always just end it. Jake, what do you think?
Oh, I thought you'd never ask. I think it's a great idea. There's nothing set in stone about our podcast or any podcast that says a guest has to come on for 2 hours straight. I have a feeling he might have 2 hours worth of stories to tell, and maybe a 30-minute segment would work better for everyone.
I'm actually on board with that for a set amount of time. Make him a bridge, whatever is happening. Mark, what do you think? Controversial character on this show. Not you, but what do you think of us having a controversial character on this show? Did your internet
I'm here. Sorry. I had to...
Poop?
On the full volume. Sorry. So, I mean, it's Brian, right? I think I agree with Brian. You can edit it out, but, you know, I don't know. I wouldn't... Do people hate him? Because I've been on websites before when I used to... In my video game days, there was a place, I think a company called RAM Controls, and they like, made
not
good
ROM
products.
ROM Controls?
RAM Controls.
Hmm.
So they made expensive parts for Star Wars cabinets, like really rare, hard to find things. So we're talking probably expensive. People hated that guy.
You and your vector graphics, man. You love
them. Yeah, you're right. You're right. Star Wars is a vector game.
See how I know things?
So he screwed people out of money, and people, I don't know this guy, so I couldn't tell you if it's poison or not, but...
I mean, it's potentially poison. I feel like...
Will he affect your podcast at all? Will people not listen to it anymore because you have him on?
That's why I'm asking it publicly.
Well, that's my job.
What, to scare people away?
I Yeah.
Certainly one of the most controversial figures in the knife collecting community that we've ever, you know, in our 10 or whatever years of collecting. He's definitely top three most.
He would probably be tarred and feathered if he went to a knife show.
Has he taken a lot of people's money? Because that's kind of
he's got about $33,000 on a Kickstarter that's been undelivered for 2 years.
Yeah, that's the same kind of thing that I would be honest. Like I would not.
Yeah,
I see how communities react to the people that promise something and then take all their money, and it's like not a good thing.
No, it's definitely not a good thing.
Oh, we're all tied up, Levon.
I know this is not enough. This didn't help at all.
This is good. Keep it in purgatory. This is what I'm trying to do.
Who DM us on a regular basis? Tell us what they think. Yeah. I'm down for going either way. Let's just put it that way.
Yeah.
Our Patreon steer this one. Oh my God, the pun king.
It wasn't me, ass clown. It was Brian.
I would never say anything like that.
No.
I'm trying to push it off on Brian.
Better watch out. I might get beat up.
I'm not gonna fuck up.
I have a, like, so Brian, do you have like a, is there like a knife code where you generally try to stay positive about other knife makers? Is that, I'm just, cause I, that's kind of like how I am about YouTube.
There should be, but, privately I'll talk to you about all of these guys, but, yeah.
I have strong opinions that I'm voicing on here.
Yeah, no, I try to be positive just about people's work, and I know that a lot of these guys are, this is how they feed their family, just like me.
Yeah, exactly.
So I try not to do any bashing, you know, that's...
Yeah. That's how I treat other YouTubers.
At the same time, I'm also one to say things the way they are, you know. Mm-hmm. So I have a lot of conflict.
Primarily.
There's a lot of internal conflict in Brian. That's why he's on mute most of the time here. when the microphones are off, it's a completely different situation. That's for the bonus content.
Yeah.
Brian is like the diplomat in the embassy and the terrorist bombing the embassy at the same time.
It's a double agent.
Yes. Well done, Jake.
So, Mark,
did we get anything new? Oh wait, what are you gonna
I was going to ask Mark what his favorite beer was now that he's moving into beer reviews, or what his favorite style of beer is.
I may not be.
Well, he's a white man, so it's obviously an IPA.
Yeah.
Nah, there was a beer review where I talked about the IPAs because that's what all the white guys drink.
The white guys with bangs that look like third wave the white emo band singers.
They got beards. No offense, you guys, but like the beard, like beards and IPAs. Yes.
Oh shit, all of us have beards in our pictures.
That's true. I like that you like it beer. That was my favorite of your beer comments.
I like IPAs. That's what I started out, you know, drinking as far as like good beers, and actually stouts probably, but you know, I like them, but I like other things. I don't have any IPAs in my house right now.
We've regressed to adult water situations. Mm-hmm. You know, Coors Light.
I drink that stuff too.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean,
and
not me.
It's a seasonal thing. When it's 200 degrees outside, Coors Light just makes sense.
I have that Kirkland branded beer from Costco.
Dude, I want that shit. There's no Costco's in Rhode Island, so I have never gotten to sample the nectar of the gods.
It's Walgreens has beer too.
Walgreens has beer?
Their own brand?
It's like Big Mountain or Big Sky or something. It's got a mountain on it. It's like
three-letter word. Like, yeah. Big Mountain.
We have very regressive liquor laws in all of New England, so I will never get to sample this Walgreens beer either.
Wah, wah.
Yeah, in Pennsylvania, you can...
Oh, you want to talk about shitty beer laws?
You open carry a pistol and a sword, but...
Can't buy a six-pack.
You can't buy a six-pack at the grocery store.
Dude.
Or anywhere on a Sunday.
The beer laws are so fucking terrible in Pennsylvania. It's unbelievable.
It's getting a little better.
The cool thing is if you're at a bar and the bar's closing, you can take a six-pack with you. You can't really do that elsewhere, but like...
Well, now, like, the shop right around the corner has a beer distributor attached to it.
Yeah. Does it have to be in like a separate room or something though?
It does.
Or they have to have to be able to sell you six packs.
Something like
that. Yeah. That's the one thing I didn't like about Pennsylvania.
Well, the good thing is you can get a beer while you're at ShopRite.
True. Dude, the beer selection at Wegmans is pretty excellent.
Yes,
it truly is.
Yeah,
Wegmans is one of the better ones. Yeah, for sure.
I had a Goose Island Bourbon County Stout there on tap once at a grocery store.
So you got fucking wasted.
It was Budweiser. It was they're owned by InBev, but Bourbon County Stout is still pretty. That's still a hype beast.
A lot of stuff is owned by Budweiser now.
Yeah,
yeah, a lot.
Elysian as well.
Yeah, and I found that out after I drank it.
Yeah, and then Ballast Point sold for $1 billion to the people that own like Corona.
If we called this the Beer Nuts podcast, it wouldn't even be about beer.
In the same way that it's barely about knives.
It's the same way that it's barely about knives. So did anybody get anything new?
Ooh.
Yeah, we all did, except for Brian, of course, but that goes without saying.
Well, he got tons of 150 production
new things.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't know you got yourself one.
No.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Well, I mean, I have a few here I can play with.
Mark, you got anything new? We'll let our guest go first.
Warranty items.
I've been buying Leatherman's because I have their pro discount, so not really any real.
Well, la di da again.
Yeah, I've blown money a lot lately, so like I don't have any money left to spend.
Yeah, I looked at my credit card bill today and nearly did a spit take.
Yeah, that's part of the reason I don't get into super expensive knives either, is because I just can't afford it.
Oh, I mean, I can't afford it either. I mean, as Outkast once said, it's not how much you make, it's how much you spend. And I really took that to heart.
Hey, yeah.
It's not from Hey God, that was from AT Aliens. Anyway. But God. Do you have a Leatherman you would suggest? I kind of need to get a multi-tool eventually, but I'm a...
The Wave.
Is it just the Wave?
Yeah, I have the what's the more expensive one? The Charge.
Yeah.
The Charge like has a wider handle because it adds titanium, so it's actually heavier than the Wave, has the same tools, and it's wider in the handle. So I don't think people like wide pliers, so why would you like a wide pliered handle?
Yeah, Leatherman? I also don't need 154 cm because I have plenty of knives.
No, so, like that's really the only advantage to that is the blade that can cut more. That's it.
Yeah, and that's not, I carry a knife for that.
The new Waves have
replaceable wire
cutters too.
Is that a good thing?
I knew you were going to say that.
You knew I was going to say that?
Yeah.
If you're fencing, yeah.
Are you guys fucking electricians? Like, you guys are both like, excited about that, Jake and Lefon.
I just knew he was going to say it because I knew that he knew it. It's the piece of Leatherman trivia that he knows.
Oh, okay.
Here's a chance to say it. I'm holding my Wave in my hand right now that is from, I want to say, like 2002 or 3 or 4. Before I started collecting knives as like an obsession, this is definitely, I have this and a super tool, and this was definitely on my belt every day for probably 5 years or something before I realized that knives are just cooler objects. But yeah, I'm totally with you on the Leatherman thing.
Yeah, it's the pliers. That's why I need it. I needed the pliers.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, if you're being real, pliers are way more useful than any other tool.
Yeah,
if you're picking up things
with them.
Yeah,
that's why I want one, is because I need a set of pliers.
Yeah, did you know that the new Wave has replaceable wires?
What the fuck wires am I cutting?
No, you're not. But I just like how it triggered Jake because he's extra snippy today because of the wire cutters.
It's not the wire cutters that made me snippy today.
Not having air conditioning yesterday.
A buddy so you remember the guy that I demoted? I was saying like, oh, my buddy came over to spine whack test that knife, and then I backpedaled real quick because I didn't want our asshole viewers or listeners to be giving me shit.
Why would you call our viewers our listeners asshole?
No, not all of them. I'm saying. Who are assholes and are going to call me out for like hanging out with my buddy and spine whacking knives for fun. Like that's something I do for fun. Anyway,
no one's calling you out on that.
So he did get, he was pretty offended that I, you know, backpedaled and said, it's just a guy I know. But anyway, that same guy just brought over.
That's not how you say that.
You said he wasn't even your friend. I heard that. You're like way back, but you're like, I don't know him.
I knew exactly when he listened.
Why wouldn't you just backpedal on the activity and not on your relationship to the person?
Was it Chris?
Yes, it was Chris.
The most Let me tell you, Chris is like one of the most tender souls on the face of the earth.
Oh, he's so easily damaged, yeah, I know.
And just writing him off as like just some dude.
Some dude, not even a friend, just
it
some
just
guy.
It broke his tender heart.
Oh, it was bad. I'll screenshot the text messages and send it to you. He's listening to this part too. So yeah. Nah, I take that back. Anyway, he has one of the awesome new Leatherman models that the name is escaping me now, but I was hoping someone would jump in and say, oh yeah, that's gotta be that blah, blah, blah. Cause it was kind of small, but it extended and it had all kinds of cool stuff going on. The long game here is I've been into knives for so long now that I forget Leatherman.
He just told you it's the OHT.
I think it is. It's the one that the pliers like come out of the front.
Come out, right? The shoot out of the front, not out the side.
That's what I'm going to send
the
you.
Side, out the pliers.
Yes. Out the side.
You know, out the front is just a matter of perspective, man.
Yes, that's true.
All knives are
out. Depends on which way you're holding it.
Depends on how you're holding it.
All knives are out
the
front. Kind of
like Ryan's dagger.
Yeah. That's an out the front.
Oh.
It cuts your hands if you open it the wrong way, though. Anyway. So, Jake, what were you saying about this?
Come back to me. I'm going to get the model.
It's called the... Dude, that's the one. It's the only one with the retractable pliers.
They're all OTF pliers, man.
What? Why? Why?
Just let him be. It's Jake. Just let him do his thing.
Yeah, but then he's gonna sit and read the whole fucking ad.
Yeah, that's true.
You guys sold the dude. I'm there's not much of this Reuniti left, man. I'm trying to do this one right for you.
What did he just say? Anyway,
the wine. Nothing about he's drunk.
The Reuniti. Drink a bottle of wine. All right.
Was it rosé?
No, it was Reuniti. I just said that six times.
Reunite.
Yeah, who's not listening now? Bitch.
Sorry. Fuck. Anyway, I actually got some knives in, so fuck all
me
y'all.
Too. And me too, and so did Dave. We all got the same one.
Oh yeah, we did.
Let's talk about that first, okay?
Yeah.
And let's also send one to Mark at some point.
Yes. We should send him all three.
Then he can see the subtle differences that you guys are seeing.
So special thanks to Charlie the Lefty on Instagram.
Oh yeah, he's a subscriber of mine too.
Yes, so
nice guy.
He is a nice guy. Although I'm going to call him on some bullshit right now. I still haven't seen that cat shelter.
Yeah,
that
he was. Where's the cat shelter at, Chuck?
Yeah, man.
Oh shit! It was the crunch. I'm sorry. No, it didn't have OTF pliers. It had actual.
We don't care about that anymore.
We've moved on.
Thanks, Rain Man.
Yeah.
It was the crunch. Chris had the crunch. Move on.
The crunch is the vice grips.
Yeah.
Yeah, that one's like hard to open compared to the. I had to watch a video on how to open it.
The death grips.
Yeah.
It's like you thought you needed pliers. Wait till you have vice grips.
Yeah, then, vice grips are like $20. The crunch is $110.
Back to this little blue knife
versus.
Can we shut up, Jake?
440C.
Shut up.
We can never do a podcast episode where Jake is drinking.
No.
At least I'm holding it together.
Yeah, I'm impressed. We all got little blue knives. Jake, you didn't actually have to mute. I kind of feel bad. I wasn't actually trying to tell you to shut up.
We got little blue pills.
Yeah. We got these little blue Tangram button locks. Oh my God. Oh my God. What is he doing?
I just shit my pants.
You said I didn't have to mute, so I filled my glass up right in front of the microphone.
Fuck, I want booze now. Damn it. Yeah, so we got these little blue Tangram knives. And
that's awesome.
They have the cheapest feeling handle I've ever felt in my life, but good thing they were $25 with the gracious coupon code sent to us by Charlie the Lefty.
Charlie the Lefty.
Who needs to build that fat cat a shelter, or else we'll publicly shame him.
Yes. I mean, the aluminum is appropriately cheap for the price.
The blade finish is better than a $500 Wii.
That is true. The satin finish.
Well, I should be specific. It's Wii Knives satin finish is absolute garbage.
It's very bad. That was a Wii 617 that didn't have a satin finish.
No, I had the black.
Yeah, yeah. It's
the nail. It had the black nail polish on it.
Well, that the black nail polish is at least evenly coated across the blade.
Yeah, honestly,
truly it was.
Their satin finishes are so bad.
Oh my goodness. It's funny. I mean, for you, Mark, having listening to us talk about the satin finish looking like trash just seems so snobby.
I would, no, don't get me wrong. I notice that stuff if you like spend a lot of money on it.
Yeah, no, I get
this. Is just like glaringly obvious too.
Yeah.
But I got one of the Something Obscene Company, actually shout out to Fanatic Edge for sending us out a couple knives to check out. Jake, you're looking at that Wii knife, unknown number, blah, 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 with the weird construction. I got one of the Valance Knife Gamma, quote unquote, mid-techs. It has the worst blade to handle ratio of any knife I've ever experienced in my life. But somehow it's still a pretty good knife. But the last one I got was the Something Obscene Company, namely Cleaver. Nothing wrong with the knife. I'm not usually a cleaver guy, but as far as cleaver designs go, Elijah Isham had some hand in the design process, and it's a good cleaver design, but it has this satin finish blade, quote unquote, and it is horrendous. Like so bad that when I got it, I actually talked to Felix at Something Obscene Company, just made him aware of it. And he was very gracious about it. I have to say that. And he's going through steps and trying to make sure that
should. Yeah, it's not his fault.
It's not his fault at all.
Yeah.
And the knife itself is decent. So if you're thinking of getting one, you should totally get one. Because if you like the design of it, you're going to like the knife.
Yeah.
It's well made.
What's the price point for those things?
I think they're in the $300 price
probably,
point.
Yeah, probably right around $300 or $350.
I can't remember. But just avoid the satin finish and you're going to be very happy.
Yeah. I mean, the mass drop, we Ferrum Forge things, I handled one, and the satin on that was no better than the $300 Wii Zeta by Elijah. They need to do, I don't know what it, like the Scotch-Brite belt that they're finishing the blades with just like totally washes everything out, but it also is like uneven too, I don't know.
And it's like they hit the whole blade. I've never seen someone take a satin finish, like a vertical satin finish to the flats as well.
Yeah, I mean, it just like rounds off the corners of the grinds, it just doesn't look good.
It looks like garbage.
Yeah, it looks like donkey dick.
But the knives themselves, no complaints. I got other things too, and I just can't remember what they were.
I'm on week 9 of my my Rex 45 Para 3.
You're not going to
get that. Yeah, especially because it's Knife Center
pre-order.
They oversell the pre-orders. This is like a constant controversy.
Yeah, we already talked about this.
I actually went and shopped for you to see if I could find one.
The Para 3s in Rex 45 just went up today and sold out in a nanosecond.
Oh, on what
Blade
site?
HQ.
Hold on, let me check something for you.
It was Blade HQ that they sold out on.
Yeah. Well, that doesn't mean anything. They sell on Blade HQ faster than anything else.
Yeah.
Yeah, I need Knife Center.
And how many do you think they sell when they're doing that?
I imagine not the whole amount that they ordered. But I mean, these runs are what, 1,200? They're sprint runs, and that's how big a Spyderco sprint run is, so.
Yeah, so each dealer's getting maybe 100, 200.
Yeah.
So, can I ask a question? Dave, you showed that new Delica that I actually like. Jake, you showed it to me the other day, too.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The red G10. Yeah.
St. Nick's.
Yeah.
So, a little side story
is it's $200 fucking dollars.
Yeah, for a Delica.
They're out there fucking gored. With the $200.
You hear that advanced steel? You hear that advanced knife, bro?
It's what steel are?
Hap 40 with a black coating and red G10 scales.
I mean, let me clarify like what I think about like production knives. The thing is you guys are complaining about like little things, and that's the thing is I think if you look at production knives, you can find a lot of flaws on anything from the $20 range to the, I don't know, at least the $450 range, which is what I've seen, and that's what I'm like. I can forgive things up to $200. Like once it gets over that, it's hard for me to.
There's diminishing returns for sure, but the point is that how much is a Delica?
A Delica is like it's 60. Now it's like $70.
Holy
it's really
shit.
Like a 40. Yeah. It's like really a $40 or $50 knife.
Yeah, okay.
The Spyderco price creep is like out of control.
Let's say one with the Spyderco's black coating, which is actually nice. The Hap 40 steel and G10 scales, does that make it $200?
No, it doesn't. G10, those materials don't like justify the price because they're not every premium. Gonzo uses G10, you know, it's fiberglass.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Like if they're using it on a machine and making it with CNC, like
it's crazy.
If they're going to complain about tooling costs and and making it from an exclusivity factor, maybe they're going to charge $90 for it. But $200? They out their goddamn mind.
Spyderco is like the martyr of the knife industry when it comes to the cost of like tooling. It's ridiculous.
Did you just try to say that in a different way wasn't you saying tooling costs all over again?
And the funny thing is that we'll wave the flag for Spyderco all day long. Love Spyderco.
Most of their frames are G10?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, G10's tough on tooling.
Fuck, now I look like an asshole.
Sorry.
It is. Thanks, Brian.
Tooling costs.
But so the Spyderco Shaman with the contoured G10 is under $200. Why is it Delica?
True, it was $155 before they raised the price, like,
the
5 or 10%.
Why is the Delica $200?
Exclusivity? I don't know. They don't seem like they're selling that fast. They had 196 left in stock. So, tell me.
That's stupid. It's stupid.
Yeah.
They overplayed.
Seriously.
You know why I'm mad? Because I wanted it, and now I don't want it anymore because it's too much money.
True.
That's all there is to it. That's why I'm salty.
That's why pretty much everybody's salty about knives.
Let me look at my Instagram and see what else new shit I got. Play the Jeopardy theme or something in the meantime.
I'll just go.
Or talk amongst yourselves. I'll amongst
go while you're looking.
Yeah, yeah.
What did I get? Oh, I got a bookshelf, which now that I'm about to turn 27, I can feel the washness just setting in. So the bookshelf was definitely my favorite acquisition of the last couple of weeks.
You're banned and fired from this podcast.
Nah, man.
Yeah, weren't we talking about knives? I mean, shit, I can talk about shit that I bought that doesn't mean a fucking thing.
I mean, it's a pretty sweet bookshelf, man.
I bought a hamper the other day. I went to Home
Goods. How was the hamper?
It's very nice.
There we go. See?
Yep. Brian was there, too. He bought a pillow just to scream into.
That was good.
No, I got a Wii 814 Chimera, which is very clip pointy and very aggressive and very metal looking, and I love it. I've been wanting it for a while.
It's the one with the centipede legs.
Yeah, and those are also like pretty sharp. Like, they didn't break the edges on any of the milling on the handle. But I don't know. It's cool. It's
you and your pussy hands.
Yeah, so I mean, if I can handle it with my pussy hands, then like the person with an average hand can handle it.
I remembered what knives I have.
Oh, good.
They're prototypes, though.
Go for
it. So I have the Tough Knives Arc Form. What's it called? Catalyst. The Catalyst. Yeah, it's pretty good. It is the first one. The Slimfoot was made by
Riot.
This one is made by Wee Knives.
Oh.
And it's arguably better. Jake, you got to handle it. What did you think? Jeff actually sent them to me to play with, so.
That was awesome. Which one was which? There was the new one.
The Slimfoot is the one that's slim and has a sheep's foot.
Right. And the one with the heavy blade is the...
The other one is the other one.
Is the newer one. Yeah. Okay, well then, it was nice. Move on.
The only complaint I have with it is that it's got, it's like a spear point grind with like a swedge, I guess. And it comes up really short. Like it's kind of thick behind the edge. I don't think you would like it.
It's got a similar grind to the Spyderco Nirvana.
Yes. I still think it's thinner behind the edge than that.
Oh, this thing is terrible without a regrind.
Yeah. But, I wish it came with like a full flat because that knife would be nasty.
It fits
in the hand nice. It's a nice design.
It's a very aesthetically pleasing grind. It just isn't practical.
Mm-hmm. I think
it was finished nice, too. The satin on the flats, I remember. Looking nice.
And it has the pivot collars, which all the kids love these days.
They do.
Mm-hmm. It's a nice knife.
So what I remember better is the Wii, is it Valiant, that you left me?
Yes.
To explore its...
I don't know what it's called. We don't call them by the names. We call them by the numbers.
It's the Wii. It's like the Chubster.
617.
617 Chode. Yeah.
The Chody one. I don't think anyone has argued against it yet. The most understated, interesting, and unique design of construction. You know, there's no... backspacer, there's no standoffs, it's just, you know, the two halves meet on the top, and the whole thing is held together by a wedge, a titanium wedge that goes in the back. So if you're on my Instagram, you can see the knife that I posted from the back, and it just has that one star. It's like a reverse Torx bit
thing
or head.
And honestly, as far as aesthetics go, Like, that's not a knife that I was ever attracted to looking at pictures of it or anything. I had no desire to own it.
I would have had no idea. If it didn't just coincidentally end up here, I would never have known that they used such a, you know, a new and unique and inventive construction method. And now I kind of want to know more. I want to know, are they going to do other knives, you know, using this?
I think they had a few.
Trapezoidal-shaped titanium wedge up the ass that they did with
this thing. It's really cool. All in the interest of making it look more like an integral.
It worked. It worked, yeah. And it's almost just as beautiful in simplicity as an integral, because it's just that one piece holding both sides and doing a damn good job of it.
Right.
Not to mention the fit. If you watch the video, I guess I'll post on Instagram right around the time that this airs, the tolerance is so just spot on that, you know, when you go to push the clip back into it, it literally, you know, all those shapes and everything are just like clicking in, and I think it would stay together without any hardware at all. So it was an interesting knife. It was, you know,
and that's surprised. the most anyone has ever talked about that knife ever.
Seriously, yeah,
ever,
because if you don't take it apart, you'd never know. Right. Oh, John Gray.
Okay. Yeah, but it's a nice knife. Thank you, Fanatic Edge, for sending that out to us. We really appreciate that.
Oh, I think I gave credit to Adam Purvis for that.
No.
Fanatic Edge. All right, I'll fix that.
That was Fanatic Edge.
Well, I mean, let's be real. 99 times out of 100, when you show up with a loaner knife, it's from Adam Purvis.
So what's funny is that that's an incredible segue that I'm... I have one of the prototypes for his Elijah Isham design folders right now. So it's another folder that he's going to be releasing soonish. He's got a couple other knives coming out before it, but the manufacturer actually made the prototype from the wrong drawing. So it doesn't have half the stuff it's supposed to have on the prototype. So there will be another prototype with like a swedge and stuff. So that Warncliffe sheep's foot style knife that I've been posting is a production knife that he's going to be releasing. And it's sort of burrowed its way into my heart. I really like that knife.
Looks good on a bandsaw.
It did. Turned out nice on that there picture on the bandsaw after I edited the living shit out of it. Anyway, I think that rounds out my acquisitions. I think I talked about most of them on the last episode. There was a lot of stuff that came in last month, and I talked about it. But there's that. We posted up our video of the Hatian, the Shurgarov Hatian disassembly.
Mm-hmm.
That turned out nice. Did you fall asleep, Mark? Mark?
No, I'm here on the mute button. You were talking about how people complain about sounds, and I'm sure I've been contributing to fidgeting with shit.
I haven't heard you at all. I think the only thing I heard was Jake's kid stomping around upstairs.
Oh, okay, cool. I'm wearing like some iPhone headphones, so I don't know how much these reject sounds. I'm not using my actual laptop microphone, so.
Why?
I'm glad you pulled out all the stops for
us.
Yeah,
he definitely pulled out all the stops. He has all the recording equipment in the world. He's using fucking packed in headphones.
Oh, that's funny. Well, so your new acquisitions weren't that interesting. What would be like on your things that you'd like to review next? Pick one or two or seven or whatever.
Let's see here. I'm gonna have to look through my Instagram feed.
Or look through our Instagrams, because maybe you can be.
Yeah, because that's where.
Here, That's a better idea. So look through your Instagram feed. Let's see. Knife Nuts Podcast. Sorry, I'm gonna just mute this for 1 second. Yeah.
Can you put some Jeopardy theme song here? Jeopardy.
I'm pretty sure that's just not public domain. So,
Dave, do you have any upcoming acquisitions, Dave? Like, I have a Rex 45 PM3 on order. Now, does Dave have anything upcoming, or you, Levon, or whatever?
I mean, I'm currently unemployed, so. It would be my best interest to not continue buying knives, but
I want a micro typhoon. I want a chicane. I want a fucking dagger. I mean, there's a lot of shit I want.
I want my parents to love me.
I want microtex.
I've always wanted a Microtech. I just can't.
Oh, God,
we're sending you a Microtech, buddy.
Yeah. Oh, God, we are sending him a Microtech.
Batoning an Ultratech will literally make it explode.
I think on the buy list is probably a Microtech out the front. I like the Bounty Hunters. They're just hard to find, I see. Do you not like the Bounty Hunters?
I love the Bounty Hunter. I love it.
It's kind of the Star Wars nerd in me.
Yeah. Did we just become best friends?
Do you want to go practice karate in the garage?
Yes.
Settle down, Jake. Don't get upset.
Oh, God. Marital drama.
That's why he's salty.
I like the Wii knives with the dragon scale. I guess the 604. I don't really like the blade on there, but
Domasteel and a recurve.
I don't really like Domasteel. I've seen Domasteel in person a few times. Obviously, that's not very impressive for this show, but I just doesn't do anything for me.
Wait, what did you wait? How do you say it, Mark?
Domasteel.
I don't know how it's said. Somebody.
Damascus
it's
steel.
It's Damasteel.
I don't know. Maybe it would be better in person.
It's a Swedish product. They definitely don't do a short A sound.
Yeah, but isn't it coming from Damascus?
Yeah, but it's not Damascus.
No, I like Wii knives. Actually, Wii knives, they have a lot of interesting designs, and I like them. I just can't afford any of the ones that I like. You know what I'm saying?
If you were adventurous enough to buy the Browse Razorback, I feel like there's probably a lot of Wii knives that you'd try out.
What sort of situation do you end up where you buy the Razorback and not...
You know what? There was a sale. There was a big, like, a half-off sale, and I didn't know what I was doing.
That's the half-off sale. That's the answer I was looking for. I didn't know what I was doing.
I was out of my mind.
So here's the funny thing about that, is that he burned every bridge he had with any dealer because of that giant sale that he had.
They're all cheap. Dude, does he make his knives in America? Because, like, it doesn't really say that anymore on any of his knives.
I'm doing a slow clap for you right now.
Because
you've entered the seventh layer of woke now.
You're woke.
When people manufacture things in America, like, they put that on their product pages. That's all I'm saying. Like, when people take that off, that's usually a sign that...
It wasn't made in America.
Also, when people make stuff in America, there's rarely photos of that product being made in China.
I just noticed that when you buy things, that's just generally they take it off the page if it's not. Because it's correct. It's a bragging point.
Unless you're quartermaster, you're just going to keep rolling with it.
So here's the other piece of that's funny. And because I know you've actually shouted out Knife Nuts podcast when you use China D2 in your shows.
Yeah.
That is a quote from China D2 is actually a quote from Jason Brouse, because at SHOT Show, he showed off a line of import knives, quote unquote, that are also D2, are mechanically and physically identical to all the knives that he's made in quote unquote the United States, but they're not made of regular D2 that his knives are made of, the USA made knives. The Chinese knives are made of China D2.
Now the Spyderco thing where they said that the steel was like 440C, but then they changed it to 8CR because that's what the formula was. Is that like that?
I guess.
Who knows what China D2 really is, but one can guess it's not D2.
I just assume that all knives that come from China are not just whatever.
The proliferation of D2
is it's made, and that's the myth that the China D2 quote has proliferated for itself. But that's where it initiated, was with him dubbing the ironically Chinese knives as China D2 and keeping his American knives, quote unquote, as regular D2.
Just funny. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't even hate the guy. Like, it's just, I just don't know him. I just don't like dishonesty. That's it. You know? 'Cause it would be so easy just to fix this. And just say, okay, yeah. No one cares that the knives are made in China anymore. You just got to be honest about it.
I have, like, cheap, like, Chinese knockoffs and shit that are, like, great. Like, I just wish I just like people being upfront with it. I believe his site used to say Made in America, but, like, when I bought the knife, but it doesn't anymore, so.
That's very funny.
I just, I remember looking at it. I'm like, oh, this is made in the U.S. I'm going to buy it. And
so it doesn't say it anywhere on his website, but he still touts it. He still touts it as American made in person.
It says it on the Blade HQ in the who's the other one? Knife Center. It says it on their websites that they're made in America.
Dealers
they still say Quartermaster's made in America.
Yeah, I've seen that too.
You guys may remember we actually talked with Ben Peterson at Blade HQ about that, about, you know, whose job is it to police that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's no real checks and balances on that. The gun community decides. yeah, well, that's just my stab, no pun intended, at the gun community, because they have universally terrible taste in knives.
Oh, daggers and I don't know.
Well, just they buy weird shit. Their priorities are very different.
Mm-hmm.
But back to the knockoff thing, and Gavin's actually coming up a lot in this episode, but what's funny about him, a lot of makers really have a zero tolerance policy against all of their people making knockoffs and shit like that. And it's like, I'm going to burn your house down sort of situation.
Mm-hmm.
But Gavin Hawk actually collects knockoffs of his products.
Knockoffs have helped me buy like the real version of them, by the way.
Sure, absolutely. What he finds is interesting is that most of the knives that they're knocking off are like things that they've made in a shed, and they're manufacturing. So he's actually learned a few things from some of the knockoffs because they're mass produced. You know, he said, mm-hmm. Oh, wow, I see the way they did this. We could probably make that better. But on top of that, there's the novelty factor of also collecting fake versions of all the shit that you make. Because it's truly not hurting their business, you know?
No, I would, like I said, like I would buy one of, I see where the value is in their knives, whereas mm-hmm. I wouldn't see it in a mass produced knife.
Oddly enough, that's one of the makers that got me into high end knives was Grant and Gavin Hawk.
So, I think one of these days it'll happen to me. But you know what? I'm actually gonna. I don't know if Wallace Edge Tools listens to this. He's a cold steel designer, and I'm gonna buy one of his fixed blades. I'm on his waiting list, and that's like $400.
The Demcos do.
Yeah,
I don't know about Wallace.
Yeah, Wallace. He designed the Colossus that I reviewed.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, he's.
That looks like a fun knife.
It's fun. It's like not practical, but it's fun.
You did have one, didn't you, Jake?
Yeah, I gave it to Victor.
That makes sense. I have a Talwar that's my house knife. That's like if anyone needs a knife in the house, I hand them a Talwar XL.
Nice.
It makes it fun.
It's a biggin.
It is a biggin. Not as big as the knives that we saw at the show last week, Brian. 50 Shades of Slash was there with his absurd collection of oversized custom folding knives. Knives that you have to see to believe. With lanyard beads that were the size of grenades.
Who's that guy that makes the huge knives? He's on my Instagram feed. The guy that makes the folders that are like stupid big.
That doesn't narrow it down.
Unfortunately, there's not a lot of people doing that now.
No, there's a guy that makes them three times as big as anybody else.
What a dubious honor.
Anthony Griffin.
Oh, Anthony Griffin. Yes, he does make some gigantic knives.
His knives are big. I haven't seen any other knives quite that big as folders. Like are there other ones?
Yeah, let me. I'm going to send a picture to the group real quick. You guys can still talk, by the way. Or not.
No.
I just have to pee.
You guys can't hear me clicking around a mouse or anything at all?
No, I can hear that now.
Okay, all right.
Can you guys hear this?
What about this?
What about now?
It's okay because Jake hasn't made many weird noises this episode, so like I think our weird noise quota is pretty low still. So
quotient.
Yeah, quota was definitely the word I was looking for there, but the words are not coming to me right now.
Do you guys mind if I leave in a few minutes?
Oh yes.
You mean you want us to be respectful of your time?
No, I got to be up at 4, and.
Yes.
And so my wife's been generously watching the toddler upstairs.
Oh, yeah. Well, we should wrap up soon anyway. Yes. So yeah. that'll be perfect.
You don't have to explain.
I think that is an Anthony Griffin knife.
Is that an Anthony Griffin?
Yeah, so that
that's an Anthony Griffin
confirms.
Knife. I know that.
So good. Yeah. Then we are confirmed.
Yeah.
I don't think people may. I've seen, like, I've watched a few of those, the things that people do on the Instagram where they flip them out and shit, and I don't think I've seen quite knives quite that big.
Yeah, they're insane.
Like, they're bigger than Cold Steels, I think, right?
Oh, yes, by far. Yeah. Well, either way, shall we wrap this up? Thank you all for listening. No, we're going to start talking about other stuff. So check us out on Patreon if you haven't. We're going to try and start doing a lot more stuff for you guys. We want to thank everybody. Maybe I'll do like a little recording where I thank everyone that's on our Patreon, and we can add that to the end.
Okay.
Does that sound like something we should do?
Okay.
Also, a big thank you to the Advanced Knife Bro.
Yes.
My favorite YouTube channel, without a doubt.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Even after I've like outed myself as like a fake knife person.
Fake knife bro. You should change your handle for like a day and see what happens.
Fake knife McPoy.
The strategic marketing when we roll out this episode and you change your name to fake knife bro. That's some real marketing.
I got my name from a subscriber, Advanced Knife Bro. He said those are some Advanced Knife Bro moves, and it was a joke and it stuck.
There we go.
That's exactly how I thought it happened.
The subscribers give me a lot of ideas in the comments, and
feel free to plug yourself right now.
Oh yeah, please subscribe to my channel. It's funny. It's humorous. Hopefully, not everything's funny to everybody, but maybe something will be funny to you.
I guess that's subjective. Yes,
humor is. Some people don't like it, and they tell me that, and they get banned. Well, if they continue to troll, they get banned. I only ban people that are obviously trolling. People that I have serious discussions with or disagreements, I don't ban those people. Those are real people. But I'm a nice guy. I'm approachable. You can send me an email if you want.
He has a lot of knives and chainsaws and lights and all sorts of stuff. Actually, I will tell you this: for anyone who's getting into flashlights,
even though I don't do them anymore.
Even though he doesn't do anymore, his back catalog of flashlight reviews is absolutely.
It made me buy my Zebra Light.
So
do you know how many Astro Lux I have now?
Yeah, you know they don't really make anything better than I've reviewed. Like the 32,000 lumen light that I reviewed. Like
I have one.
That's it. Like they haven't made one brighter.
No, so and like, everyone's.
Tell him what I have. Everyone. I have one of the Giggles Giga Throwers.
Oh yeah, so do I. I've been meaning to review that. Oh. I just haven't.
Well, do the review.
Did you review the DX80? I can't remember.
Yeah, I have the DX80 is that's a Ace Beam, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I have that.
No,
too.
The DX80 is Immolent.
Immolent.
Oh no, yeah.
That's the 32,000 boy.
Yeah, I have the DX80. I have the one that was before that, which is the
DT70. Yeah.
I'm looking at it right now.
I wasn't a big fan of the DT70, but I like the DX80 a lot.
I don't like Immolent's user interface a whole lot.
The DX80 is easy. I didn't like.
Yeah, but I don't like two buttons. I like one button.
DX80 is one button.
DX80 is one.
Yes, it's one.
I have an idea for.
I retract all statements of the Advanced.
Oh yeah, you're right. It is. You're right. The DT70 is a two button one. You know what? The Giggles Thrower. That's the best user interface right there.
That, like, I have an idea for your Giggles Thrower video. I'm gonna send you mine. You'll have the only video with two Giggles Throwers. You can mount them on a tripod, aim them at each other, see which one blows up first.
Oh, that's actually a really good idea.
Aim one into each eyeball.
From a mile away.
From a mile away, yeah.
Yeah, those are amazing. I shot it on the beach when I went camping like a month ago, and I brought along that other, the what's that other company that I, oh yeah, IF Sekhmet, Silent Thunder Ordnance.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that one is actually probably the farthest throwing light I have, but it's like a laser point, and most people don't really need that.
Pointless. It's literally, it's got a laser, it's like a laser point, and it's pointless.
It's great if you use optics to spot things, but like, I don't think that's like being like, negative to that. That's just what it is.
It's like something that a Mortal Kombat villain would use.
Yeah, although they have updated the heads and they look a lot better. You can actually get it switched out.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you can get them like with a black plastic or 3D printed head or whatever.
I did a video about that a while back.
The Lance of Ra.
Lance.
Yeah, the Lance. The Lance of Ra, you can get a regular looking head that doesn't look like that.
It doesn't look like a shitty painter's tape
thing. Yeah, no, it's like a I have a video like 3 months ago that shows the updated head on it. It looks
normal. I remember seeing it. It looked interesting. Yeah. So there was at that show last week, somebody had one of the giggles throwers. And it was like, and everybody came up to it was like, oh, that might light up the whole room. And I was like, nah.
No, it doesn't. It's not. It's not designed to be bright. It's designed to throw far.
Yes. But I didn't interject at this show because it was USN people.
You got to let them be, right?
You got to let them be. Yeah. but anyway, thank you so much for coming on, man.
Yeah.
It's been a long time coming, really.
Yeah, you've been asking me for a while. I finally got the time.
Well, not that long. We haven't been asking you that long. I mean,
maybe six months, 5 months.
Now we sound desperate.
We are desperate.
We are.
You know, somebody else has asked me to come on their, I think, Gear Geeks, but they don't get back to me very fast. Like, I'm like, hey, I got a weird schedule. So if they're listening.
We got the exclusive shit here.
Yeah, that's right.
I did one other interview with some dude that was interviewing me for like his thesis or something, and I don't ever know what happened with that.
He failed.
We did a video chat and he recorded it, and I rambled on for a long time. This is why I make short videos and I do the voiceovers, is because I can edit out, you know, this.
Yes, it's good. No,
I play my strengths and weaknesses, you know.
That's how we roll, buddy. We're just all weakness here.
Yeah. We play to our weaknesses.
But as always, thank you everybody for listening. We'll try and get this stuff more frequently.
Play him out, Jake.
He sounds more and more like a cat in heat every single
week. I love
it.
Okay. I'm gonna stop recording. I'm starting recording because I need to say that that was a great review.
Let me just do a, should I just do a little intro? What do you want to do?
Yeah. This will be the bonus track.
Believe it, Mark, we have done this before.
You know what? I haven't. So, I mean, I've used Google Hangouts, but not for this.
So, a couple things to be aware of. You know, try not, we'll try not to talk while other people are talking, but that rule gets broken every 4.5 seconds. Mm-hmm. Fidgeting with stuff, generally not a good idea, just because all those sounds. It happens a lot, but, you know, especially since we're all... I literally left all my knives upstairs because I will be flipping one if I sit up.
Okay, let me move some of these out of my way.
We have a guy that routinely complains about mouse clicking sounds, so there's that's okay. That's how these things happen.
And Dave, tonight try to watch your like.
Yeah, just for that one guy.
I love how Brian gets blamed for taking bong hits when it's just Jake and his vape.
I know.
Dude, has not been since like the first episode where I even owned a vaporizer. Yeah. I'm mute.
Did you quit vaping?
Your vaporizer is basically Julian's rum and coke.
It's just always by your side.
You talking about those volcano things?
Oh no, no,
no, no. His is even more useless. It's just vapor.
Yes. Well, because I don't partake in the illegals.
Oh, okay.
Mine really is just vapor.
Oh, okay.
Cool. Well, I didn't even smoke a bowl, so here we are. You're not in law enforcement, are you, Mark?
No, I'm not.
Okay, good.
No, I'm not a snitch.
You guys would know that he's not a narc if you watch the setup video for his YouTube content.
We know. But it was funny anyway.
I will say this is the first episode where I'm actively drinking during it, so this could go quite badly.
I got 2 beers down here, so... I mean, I got more in the fridge, but
I should go get a handle of vodka or something. I feel left out.
Handle.
Yeah, I'm gonna be drinking Reed Needy when things get spicy.
Brian, you're fucking lit, aren't you?
Of course. Good. I'm awake, aren't I?
Yeah, there you go. Good. All right, let's start. We'll just, you know, we play it fast and loose, Mark. I hope you're okay with that. Not as organized as you.
I'm not organized.
Let me just say there's not multiple shots in this audio recording.
Yeah.
Fine.
It's one take. It's like the Birdman of podcasts.
One horrible, horrible, horrible take. All right, here we go. Are we recording?
Yeah. No, we've been recording.
Oh.
Oh wow, this is some great bonus material for the end of the.
It's the bonus track.
The podcast.
We've already established that, Levon. You were.
Keep up, man. Chatty. Keep up, old man.
Shut up. Keep up. All right.